Okay, today we're talking about what I've called, for the sake of shorthand, doctrines of the supernatural. Sounds like we're going to start sharing a scary TV show here. We're going to talk about four themes that I've lumped under supernatural, and those are the topics of miracles, prayer, which is closely related to miracles in many ways, angels, and demons. I taught a class, which is it's what some of you were here early and saw me looking at that. I taught a class called The Truth About Angels and Demons many years ago, and one of the realities is that there probably is nothing that is messing people up more these days, or at least in the last, decade or so, than the whole angels and demons thing. You know, I don't have any of them anymore, but when I taught the class, I had purchased a bunch of books like How to Contact Your Guardian Angel and things like that, and it is so messed up. But we'll get to that, all right? Let's begin our conversation today talking about miracles. And I want to start out by telling you, I've said to you before how much I really like Wayne Grudem's book, but that I don't agree with everything. One of the things up until now that I've disagreed most on is his definition of what's a miracle. It feels to me as though he defines miracle in a way that doesn't mean anything, and then he goes to extensive length to try to argue that, for instance, he makes a long argument about how we can't have a concept of miracles that can be answered by something that's not really miraculous, when in fact his definition is exactly that, in my mind. Wayne Grudem's definition, and I'm not picking on him, this is to help us get an understanding, and since you're reading the book, Grudem's definition is, a miracle is a less common kind of God's activity in which he arouses people's awe and wonder and bears witness to himself. Now, again, he goes on at some length, for those of you who have read this, to say your concept and definition of miracle can't be something that would be satisfied by just natural occurrence. So it's got to be something else going on. And I read this and I go, well, somebody standing on a mountaintop in the middle of the night and looking up at the night sky and seeing a shooting star, would that not qualify as a less common kind of God's activity that arouses people's awe and wonder, and, if they're open to it, bears witness to himself? And yet, would we call a shooting star, in most instances, a miracle? I mean, you could say anything in nature is miraculous. Or the meteor showers, or things of that sort. I think Grudem's definition falls short. So let me give you my definition. Ross Arnold's definition.
This is the one to pass with.
This is the one you want to know. When you get to it, you will see that, according to Ross Arnold, a miracle is, I'm being real clear, this is my definition, an event or occurrence in which God acts or allows his servants to act with intentionality in a way not limited by the usual boundaries of natural law which he has put in place. Now, Grudem says, well, a miracle is an event where the natural law is superseded. And he doesn't like that because he said that suggests that the natural law is somehow apart from God's control of the universe or God's intentions. When in fact, the natural law was put in place by God. And so that's why my definition says limited by the usual boundaries of natural law, which he, God, has put in place. All right? Now, anybody want to argue with my definition?
Oh, that's good.
That's a foolish answer.
Okay. And let me talk about that natural law thing before, because Grudem doesn't get into this, and I think this is critical, really, for our understanding of what is a miracle, what is miraculous. First, I would say, God created the natural law, or you might say the natural order of things, and he did so for our protection. Again, Grudem misses it, I think, because he assumes that when we talk about the natural law, we assume, well, we mean God had nothing to do with it. I insist that God created the natural law. And the natural law is basically, in the order of the universe, there is a predictable cause and effect. That's what the natural law means. If I plant corn, because I need to feed my family, marigolds are not going to come up. If I throw a light switch, assuming that, the juice is on and the bulb is intact, then the lights are going to come on. If every time, I used to say, when I've talked about this before in Seattle, Ballard is one of the Norwegian community near Seattle, and I said, if every time I turned on a light switch, there was a 50-50 chance that a house in Ballard was going to blow up, then I probably wouldn't be able to light my home with electricity. In other words, the natural order is God's way of protecting us by allowing us to have some reasonable ability to know the consequences of our actions or the actions of other things in the world. Make sense?
Yes.
The natural order is exactly what God intended because He made it. That's the first premise I think we need to understand when we talk about miracles. Talking about the natural order does not mean we are excluding God. In fact, we're giving God credit for being the author of that natural order. Else nothing makes sense. David Hume, the great Scottish philosopher, an epistemologist, epistemology is the philosophy of how do we know things. Hume was the great skeptic. He's the one who said, you don't know. Just because something has happened 9,999 times in the past, there was a cause and effect. You don't know it's going to happen that way the 10,000th time. You know, if a cue ball hits a pool ball a certain way with a certain spin, a certain amount of force, a certain angle, you can say, well, cause and effect says it's always going to go the same direction. If it gets affected the same way, or the cause hits it the same way, the effect is going to be the same. Hume said, that's just habit. We don't know that. Well, in the process of doing that, he actually did much to dismantle our whole understanding of cause and effect and our whole understanding of the reasonableness of the universe and of God's being the one in charge of that. But Hume even said, even though he was the author of that, and no one has ever effectively, philosophically argued against Hume's principles, Hume's skepticism. But even Hume said, but you can't live like that. You can't eat beans today and it's fine that you eat beans tomorrow and all of a sudden the beans have become poisonous just because there's no predictability in the universe. Okay. So God created the natural law or natural order of things for our protection so that we would know what will happen as an effect of certain cause. Secondly, God does not permit natural law to be subverted by our own authority by appealing to spiritual forces outside ourselves that are not God. What does that mean? That means no calling on spirits, no trying to perform magic, no trying to seek supernatural means other than God Himself to try to change the natural order, because that's what magic is. Magic is an attempt to change the natural order of things without having God involved. Right? You say certain words, certain incantations, you use certain potions, and you are able to accomplish something for which there is no natural explanation. God is very clear that the natural order is there for our protection, and therefore we are clearly forbidden in Scripture from doing anything by our power or by the power of some other supernatural force, demons, magic, whatever it is, to subvert the natural order. Because if we take the, you know, if we take the cork out of that bottle and natural order is no longer in place, we don't stand a chance. Neither does anybody else. Natural order is necessary for our survival. And that Scripture is plain. No divination, no spiritism, no calling up the dead, no performing magic, witches, not allowed. That's why the Old Testament deals with that. The New Testament gets into it a little bit, Simon the Magician and others. But there is never an excuse for us seeking supernatural changes in the natural order apart from God Himself doing it. Yes, Terry?
Just have trouble with the word natural because to me it's like intuition. It depends on your definition of the word natural. It depends on your definition of intuition. So, can you speak a little bit more about what you and
well, natural,
mean natural?
God made nature. God made a certain order in the universe.
Nature and natural order.
Well, let me continue with that.
Okay.
There's a reason that they have the same root. It means the way things... God is responsible for organizing all of creation. He didn't just make it. He made it in an organized way. Well, that organized way and the way in which the organized pieces of the natural world, that's where I use nature there, the pieces of the natural world relate to each other in predictable ways, which is the natural order, okay, or natural law. All of that is according to God's intention. He made all the pieces, He made them in a particular structured way, and He made them to interact with each other in a certain way. He made oil and water not mix. for instance. And when you look at some of the complex chemical properties of things like water, if God had not made them the unique way that they are in the natural, in nature, in the natural order of things, then we couldn't survive. For instance, any of you all are in physics, if water, like the water in a lake, should freeze from the bottom up, but it doesn't. It freezes on top. What would happen to the creatures like fish and other things that lived in that lake if the water froze from the bottom up? They couldn't survive. And so there is some unique property of water which physicists are not actually able to fully understand, because they say all we know about the way elements work, water should freeze from the bottom up. It doesn't. And yet the survival of all, you know, aquatic life is dependent upon the fact that there's that strange quirk. Well, that's an example of a natural order, a natural law, as reflected in the characteristics of nature, that God specifically had a hand in. He knew what he was doing. So when I say natural law or natural order, I mean the order that God put in things to make them work together right. Is that fair?
Gravity
is one of those things. Okay. I mean, you know, so that we don't fly off into space. Yes, Mike.
I've got a little bit of a background in physics and quantum mechanics and string theory. And so my definition...
Just a little. A little experience, yeah.
And what I was going to say was that my definition of a miracle is the operations of the laws of another universe operating in this universe.
Okay. That's not inconsistent with what I'm saying. When I'm saying that the natural law, because we're talking about what exists in this universe, are in some way set aside or superseded. And you'll notice, by the way, let me back up. I said that an occurrence in which God acts or he allows his servants to act. The apostles perform miraculous healings. They are not God, but it was by God's empowerment and instruction and direction that they did those things. Or allows his servants to act with intentionality. I didn't mention that, but that's very important, because it means we're not talking about something that happens by accident. Miracles don't happen by accident. Miracles happen because of intentionality, which means somebody did it on purpose. There was an intent behind it. Okay? So that's a critical part of this, that the natural order that God created, miracles are when that gets superseded with intention, because either God did it or God had one of his servants do it. There's no other reason, there's no other way in which we can conceive of that, okay? Now, God created the natural order for our protection. God does not permit us to subvert natural law by any other means. Yet, that being a fact, God is compassionate towards our limitations. He knows there are times in which we feel great need, but we're unable to address those needs under the restrictions of natural law. I have, you know, a family member who's had a car accident someplace far away, and there's nothing I can do to be of help to them. But I can pray for them. I can pray for God to in some miraculous way, to supersede that circumstance. Or someone is sick and the doctors say they can't be healed. Or any other circumstance whereby the natural processes or the natural order does not give me the feeling that, you know, that's not going to meet the need. God in his compassion recognizes that we sometimes find ourselves trapped between the brokenness of this world and our having to deal with that, and the fact that we don't have the power to supersede the natural law, and God is compassionate on us. God wants to give us an option. Those options don't include witchcraft, magic, spirits, that kind of thing. Because then we're trying to go around God to break the natural law. So, at such times, in his compassion, God and only God can set aside his own natural law to help us by miraculous means. That's what a miracle is. When God does something that is outside or above or in addition to, however you want to say it, his own natural law in order to achieve something, most often for our benefit, because we have asked him for that. Okay? Does that make sense?
There's a question about astrology, because astrology, and I'm no expert on it at all, but it has something to do with reading stars and alignment and times,
right,
and things like that. And I think that God creating the universe and all of these natural laws, that there are many things we don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
That as time goes on and we learn from generations before us, and some of the ancient Phoenicians and the way they read the stars to navigate and things. So all that's there, we just don't discern it.
Yeah, the problem is scripture says that that's not allowed.
No.
The scripture says very plainly, astrology, looking to the stars for guidance, is not allowed. Now, let me make an important point here. When I talk about magic and spiritism and astrology and things like that, it's not, those things aren't allowed because they're not real. They're not allowed because they are real. I believe in the power of magic. I don't doubt there may be some truth in astrology. I don't doubt that you can seek demonic help to break the natural law. I am not doubting any of those things. But the problem is, since all of them are in effect trying to go around God, go around God's natural law without involving Him in the process, they're not allowed.
So even though He created the stars, the moon, and the heavens, it's still not allowed.
He also created the demons. We don't call on them either.
Right, okay.
Okay?
Good distinction. Okay.
That there are things in the created world, physical and spiritual, that may have power. But we're not allowed to access those powers.
But God says that's bad for us.
Exactly. He's saying it's for our protection. That's number one.
Right.
The reason God put the natural order in place and said, you don't mess with this, you don't mess with this for your own protection. The only thing you can do, if you really need to, if your heart is really burdened by something that the natural law is preventing you from addressing, you can come and ask me. And God in His love and in His power and in His wisdom may choose to set aside some aspect of His natural law to achieve a miracle. But only He can legitimately do that. There is nothing else. And I've had people say to me before, well, you know, there's power in crystals. And if we, and I said, I don't know if there is or not, but the point is, if you try to subvert or mess with the natural order of things that God created by some physical or spiritual power that is not God, you are breaking the rules. And it is to your own peril. That's the reason those are rules are there. It's not just because God decided sometime He didn't like witches. It's because we're opening Pandora's box when we do that. And we cannot control the consequences, and God does not want us to do it because He's concerned about our well-being. Kenneth?
A good example of that is Saul seeking help from the witch of Endor.
Right.
And there's no indication that that was not really Samuel
who
came forth. And what's interesting is when you look at Saul, when he's mentioned after that, he is mentioned with, and Saul even did this horrible thing by going to a witch.
Right.
And it's not treated like him.
If you know the story, toward the very end of his life, after Saul had already offended God, David had already been anointed and become powerful, and Saul had been trying to kill David, right before his last battle with the Philistines, Saul goes to a witch, the witch of Endor. Now, Saul, early on, had driven all the witches out. And the witch of Endor thinks that maybe he's trying, you know, that it's entrapment. But you got rid of all the witches in the kingdom, you know. What are you at? And he goes, no, I'm not going to bother you. I need you to call up the spirit of Samuel. And we don't know how that works. Okay? And we're told that she calls up a spirit, and it is Samuel. And Samuel said, why are you bothering me and my rest? And he asks questions about, well, is God going to bless us? And Samuel says, no, you are going to die, and your sons are going to die. This is not going to be a good day for you. And they proceed to be killed by the Philistines in the battle, like the next day. But Ken is right. There is no indication in that this wasn't actually the spirit of Samuel. But even Samuel, the spirit of Samuel says, you should not be doing this. So, you see where I'm going with that. Miracles are only, that is, setting aside doing anything to affect the natural order of things, the natural law, is only to be done by asking God's intercession, not by any other means or power, physical or spiritual. And that's a really important thing for people to understand. Just because it works doesn't mean it's good. Mm-hmm. Yes, Eric?
I just had a quick question about what is the definition of a seer in the Bible? The people they would go to, in my mind, I always thought they were supposedly reading things like runes or whatever.
A seer is actually another word for prophet.
Okay.
Quite a few of the prophets, for instance, Nathan, in a couple places is called prophet, and in a couple places he's called a seer.
Okay.
When Saul and his servant are out looking for the donkeys that are missing, you know, before they meet, they meet up with Samuel, who God has told him to anoint this guy when you meet him. The assistant the servant of Saul says, in the next village, there is a famous seer. Mm-hmm. So that's a word that's synonymous with prophet.
Okay.
It's not, that does not suggest spiritism or anything
okay.
of that sort.
Okay. Thank you.
When it's talking about somebody like that, they call them, they refer to them as witches, or those who call up spirits, or astrologers, or things of that sort. It's very clear when they're talking about that.
Okay.
So, we've established the definition and criteria for miracles. Sorry, Wayne. So why miracles? It's God's willingness to intercede into his own natural order for our benefit, but there's several practical reasons or reasons we can see. First, it's often to demonstrate God's power and his authority even over the natural order that he put in place. Jesus performed miracles for two reasons. One, to show God's power, which was resident in him as the Son of God. That's one reason he did it, is to show people I'm not just another teacher. There are other examples besides just Jesus where God demonstrates his power, his authority over the natural world by performing miracles. And so that's one of the ways, is to show that God is not limited by natural order. He made it, he can set it aside when he wants to. Second is to give evidence of God's presence and activity. Jesus talked about, you know, when I am here with you, the kingdom of heaven is in your midst, or the kingdom of God is in your midst, depending upon which the Gospels you're reading. And it was a way, and then he performed miracles to demonstrate that God truly was present in this thing. And frequently the expression that they have for Jesus is that we know that you are the Son of God because of the miraculous power you demonstrate. So miracles can demonstrate God's presence and his activity. That's the reason that the apostles were given the power to do miracles when the church was just being planted. It's because it sort of cut through the skepticism and made them aware that this was God's work. That God was here, God was working, God is active. This is real. Okay. A third reason is to help those who are in need, especially if they are beyond help by natural means. Again, that's the second reason Jesus performed miracles. First, to show the power and authority of God, resident in himself. And secondly, to help those in need. We're told that that Jesus looked on the people and felt pity because of their travail, because of the burden of just living in their life as difficult as it could be, and especially on people who were sick, and on people who were outcasts, and on various other people, that Jesus, when outcast, most often in the case of Jesus' time, was because of a physical ailment. If you had leprosy or any skin disease or various other things, you were an outcast, which means you not only suffered physically, but you suffered socially and emotionally and psychologically as well. And Jesus interceded in those things, for those needs. And fourth, to demonstrate the truth of the gospel message. Again, in Jesus, in the apostles, and in times since the apostles, miracles occur in order to demonstrate this is real. This is true. This you should believe. So, the conclusion I draw from that, since all of these needs still exist today, and Grudem makes this argument as well, there's no reason to suppose God does not still do miracles today. In fact, if you live anywhere other than the skeptical Western world, if you lived in some other part of the world, there are regular and frequent reports of miraculous events associated with the church. You're nodding, Chris. You work with missionaries overseas. You know, same thing with me. Now, you know, I've worked enough with overseas people. Miracles is something they just expect. So why don't we see miracles? Why do we not experience miracles all the time? I think it's because we're not looking for them. Because down deep, as products of our Western culture, we don't really believe it, even though we say we do. There's a part of us that is skeptical about that. From the Enlightenment on, the basic thing that happened from the Enlightenment on that has caused such grief for the Christian faith and led to all sorts of, you know, Bultmann's demythologizing and on and on and on, has been one thing. No longer believing in anything supernatural. Everything else is linked to that. We don't believe in miracles. We don't believe in the supernatural. Therefore, Jesus could not have been God. Jesus could not have walked on water or raised the dead or turned the loaves and fishes into enough to feed 5,000 people or anything else, because those things can't happen. And from there, the whole thing unravels. if you do not accept that the miraculous, which is in some ways another way of saying the supernatural, because the existence of the supernatural is a necessary predicate to the occurrence of miracles, then nothing else works. We might as well fold our tents and go home. And yet that is the dominant philosophical orientation of the Western world today, is that there isn't really anything supernatural, and therefore there is no such thing as miracles. And because we've all grown up in that milieu, even if we grew up in Christian homes or whatever it is, we've grown up in a culture for which that is the dominant belief system, down deep, most of us aren't looking for miracles because part of us doesn't believe they really exist. Miracles are given to those who have enough faith to believe that they're real. So some people still experience miracles today, for sure. The fact that we don't probably should tell us something about our own spiritual beliefs. Okay? Further about miracles. There are such things as false miracles. That is, demonstrations of power that come from demonic sources of magic, divination, spiritism, etc. As I said a minute ago, when I say that those things are not okay for us, it's not because I don't believe there's power there. Now, there's not great power there. We're going to talk about angels in a few minutes, and one of the realities is that angels, because of their rebellion against God, their sin, in effect, because angels can sin too, they are weakened. Because sin breaks us. It weakens us. Weakens them. So, all of these things, magic, divination, spiritism, etc., none of them are of sufficient power to compete with the things of God or the miraculous power of God. But there still can be power there. That doesn't make them okay. In fact, all the more reason to stay away from them is because they are real. And so false miracles can happen. When the priests of Pharaoh did the various miracles, some of them may have just been magic tricks. I mean, you know, sleight of hand, some of them may have actually been magic, but they reached a point beyond which they couldn't go. Their power was limited. The power that God had given Moses and Aaron to demonstrate his presence in this situation were far greater than that. And so they reached a point where the priests of Pharaoh had to say, hey, I'm out. I got nothing. That's it for me. Not so with those who were serving God. Second, answered prayer is one of the most common ways in which people experience miracles. Because answered prayer, in most cases, involves God setting aside his natural law in some way. My assumption is that we don't often pray for things that are given. All right, we pray for healing. Now, related to that, let me give you the next point. Miracles occur at different speeds. There is such a thing, and in this way I disagree with Grubnigan, because he talks about miracles always happening like that, you know. I don't think so. I think sometimes God performs miracles over a period of time. And I heard a sermon, I still remember one time, using Isaiah 40:31, this passage. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength, they will soar on wings like eagles, they will run and not grow weary, they will walk and not be faint. Well, the sermon I heard, which I have always remembered, and was very meaningful to me, is that this passage, they will soar on wings like eagles, run and not grow weary, walk and not be faint, are the three ways in which God performs miracles in our lives. Say someone is sick. It is possible, and if you haven't had it happen in your own life, how many of you actually know of some healing or some other event that you think was a miracle? More than half, okay? So it's not like it's rare. The idea that someone had a massive tumor and right before they went in for surgery, they did another x-ray and the tumor wasn't there, that immediate, miraculous relief from whatever the problem was, is like soaring on wings like eagles. It's also true that someone may have, say, a cancer, for example, and using chemotherapy, radiation, whatever the treatment is, over a period of time, that disease leaves their body, they go into full remission, and never suffer from it again. I don't know about you, but I think that modern medical techniques that are able to cure diseases that a decade ago we didn't stand a chance with, but that's a miracle. It doesn't happen like that. It takes some time. And yet, I believe that it is a miracle of God that treatments like that are available. That's running and not growing weary. Having to take time to get the miraculous healing of God using techniques that God allowed people to discover. And then they will walk and not be faint is a way of saying that if, for instance, we have an illness or some other trial, God does not miraculously take it away. He doesn't provide a cure for it over time. But at the very least, He will always be present with us to encourage us as we walk. We may not be able to soar like eagles. We may not be able to run. But as we walk with that continued illness, there is a miracle in the fact that God walks with us by His Holy Spirit. That in itself is a miracle. So to me, I love that analogy. I think it's very apt, and it tells me that not all miracles happen instantaneously, that miracles occur at different speeds. They are still miracles. You talk to somebody 50 years ago about being able to cure some of the diseases we cure today. Do you not think they perceive that as a miracle?
I thought in the book that I had read that he said it, that miracles can occur in phases and in different intensities. Did I misread that?
Well, when he talked about different phases, he sort of meant like boom, and then boom, and then boom. Whereas I think it's you know, it's possible for it to be a consistent acting over a period of time. He was saying that God may reveal His miracles in spurts at various times in order to build up the emphasis on the miraculous occurring, as I understood it. Okay, I don't want to misread him. Some of you understood him be saying that same thing, then I'll give him credit for it. Okay? But I think that there may be a persistent. One of Eugene Peterson's early books, which he's taking the Song of Ascents from the Book of Psalms, which is there's a group of psalms that are called the Song of Ascents about going up to Jerusalem, the ascent. And the name of the book is A Long Obedience in the Same Direction, which is a wonderful expression. And to me, the fact that God can heal us over time, you know, slowly, in an evolving kind of way, that His healing can occur, is like a healing version of a long obedience in the same direction. Okay? All right. And Grudem talks about this. There are right reasons and wrong reasons for Christians to seek miracles. If you seek a miracle for healing out of compassion, it's perfectly legitimate, whether it's for you or somebody else. If you seek a miracle that God's glory would be known, for instance, that people would experience the miracle and be caused to consider more seriously the things of God, very legitimate. But if you want a miracle for entertainment, like we read about, you know, Herod, when he met Jesus, he thought, oh, great, I've been wanting to see a good trick. I have known people like that today. The people who were part of the signs, you know, the charismatic signs movement. I remember talking to a girl one time, and she said, I was at this meeting, and they were lengthening legs, and I thought, cool, I've never seen a leg lengthen. And I'm thinking, really? Is that the point? I don't think it is. It was entertainment. And that's not why we're supposed to be asking for this stuff. Not for entertainment, not to make us look good. You know, Simon the magician wanted the apostles to give him the ability to do the kind of miracles they had been doing because that's how he made his living. He was going to make a profit off of it. So there are bad reasons, there are wrong reasons, but there are also right reasons. Again, if it's for the glory of God or out of compassion for someone who has need, it's never wrong to ask for a miracle. Okay? And we should be more bold in doing so, because miracles can happen today as well. I don't think, I said earlier, we don't see miracles because we're not looking for them, or we don't have faith in them, or whatever. I don't think it's true that we don't have miracles today. I think that God does not give us as many of the more dramatic miracles. And I think it's because He's saying, you know, with a little more faith, you'd be amazed at what you can experience. He's calling us to a higher level of commitment and faith in Him in order for us to experience some more of that miraculous kinds of events in our lives. Okay, miracles. Any questions about miracles? Let me move on. Wendell.
Yes, sir. Can you elaborate on miraculous miracles?
I thought that's what we've been talking about for the last 40 minutes. What do you mean?
That answered my question.
Okay, yeah, we're talking about, like when we talk about soaring on wings like eagles, that's when it's just a completely inexplicable, instantaneous, you know. But I think that A miracle is anything that we say we can't really understand, given the nature of the natural order of things, given how things work. How did that happen? And again, we say, well, you know, with medication, cancer tumors disappear. Ask somebody 20 years ago if that was possible, and they would tell you, man, that's a miracle. So, anytime the natural order of things is set aside, it is a miracle. But only God can do that as we seek Him. Okay? Let's talk about prayer, because prayer is related to this. It is often in response to prayer that we see miracles occur, either dramatic instantaneous miracles, or a process of the miraculous occurring in someone's life, or at least the sustaining. Often during the pastoral prayer on Sunday morning when I pray for people, I more often than any other single thing, I will pray that the Holy Spirit be present with them to provide encouragement and strength in the midst of the suffering that people may be experiencing. Doesn't mean I don't believe in miraculous healing, but I know at the very least that's available. Even if God, for His in His wisdom and His grace and His love, does not choose to miraculously heal someone, He has said His Holy Spirit would be available to him. And that too is a miraculous thing. Okay, so prayer. Definition first. Prayer is personal communication with God. And it clearly does imply a relationship. It is talking with God, not talking to God. Let's face it, most of us, meaning Christians in the West, we perceive as prayer as being telling God what we want. It is our spiritualized version of going to Santa Claus with our wish list. Here's what I want, Jesus. As though He were some sort of cosmic bellhop, and all we had to do was ring the bell and tell Him what we wanted, and He's going to deliver all of our desires with a little umbrella in them. And that's what we think prayer is. And if we don't get everything that we ask for, then I'm not going to have anything to do with that God. Anybody who says that misunderstood what prayer was in the first place. Because it is relationship. Now, let's recognize that almost everybody does this. A survey, U.S. News and World Report did a survey a few years ago that 78% of all Americans prayed at least once a week. Sorry about the Canadians, this is just the study done in the U.S.
It's higher up there.
That's because they're cold and they're inside. 57% of Americans say they pray every day. 20% of professed atheists or agnostics confess to praying daily.
What?
You know, they say there's no atheists in the foxholes? Because everybody at some point finds the need to appeal to a higher power. On any given day, more people will pray than will go to work, exercise, or have sex. Prayer is a fairly universal experience, whether we're doing it right or not, whether we understand what it is or not. This idea of it being a personal communication with relationship. It is a relational communication. Now, think about it in very practical terms. If I'm in a relationship with Carolyn, which is hard because she's always gone, I say we have a relationship. If I never speak to her other than to ask her to do something for me, what kind of relationship is that? How long is it going to last? A relationship can only occur when there is communication, and that communication has to be shared and mutual, bi-directional, or there is no relationship. A relationship where one person does nothing other than ask the other to give them something all the time is not a relationship. The same thing is true in our relationship with God as that analogy between people. Okay, now, I think it's very important and useful for us to understand that with the word prayer, as it is translated in the New Testament, there's four different words that we translate prayer, and they all have different meaning in the original Greek. So you're about to get a Greek lesson. The first word that is used is aiteo. Aiteo means to officially or formally request or demand, almost always for yourself. It's sometimes negative in the way it's used in the New Testament. It means demanding your rights. I'm a citizen. I have rights. And you have to give this to me. Or at the very least saying, well, you know, I do have a right to this. That word, which is translated prayer, in the New Testament, our English New Testament, is a very different word than the other three. The second level, and each of these are progressively more intimate, meaning from the very formal to the more intimate. The second word is diomai. We translate prayer. It means to request something to address a need or a lack. And it's used courteously and even warmly. None of this, it's never negative, and none of this officialness about it. It's courteous, it's warm, it's reflecting an address to address a need. The third level, the word is erotao. It means an intimate or a personal request, what we would ask of a spouse, a mate, a close friend. So it's a much closer, more intimate word. But the most common word in Greek that we translate prayer in the New Testament is the word prosukomai. This word means to draw near to seek the presence and participation of, to earnestly desire partnership with God in accomplishing a need. It means to invite God to come along with us to address the need that we feel. It's relational in the sense that we are asking for a partnership effort with God. An example, Philippians 4, 6, and 7, Jesus says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer, prosukomai, and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Now, why does asking God for things transcend understanding, guard our hearts and minds in Jesus? Because if we're doing this kind of prayer, we actually are becoming more intimately related to and involved with God. That not only will frequently give us what we're asking for in prayer, but it will change us spiritually. It will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. It is a relational aspect. Another passage which mystifies people is when the disciples, after they've gone out, they've been casting out demons and healing people and all sorts of stuff, by the power Jesus gave them, they come back and there is a young boy who's been possessed by a demon. It throws him into the fire and into the water, and his father is saying, "Please, your disciples tried to heal my son and they were not successful." And the disciples said, "Why couldn't we?" And Jesus heals him. And the disciples say, "Why couldn't we heal this boy?" And Jesus said, "Well, this kind of demon only comes out with much prayer." And you go, "Well, weren't they praying?" It says, this sort of demon will only come out with much prosukomai, with much involving of God in the process, not just asking God, but partnering with God, bringing him alongside to make this happen. That passage doesn't make any sense unless we understand that the word for prayer there is different than many of the other times that we have a Greek word that's translated prayer. So everything about this most common word, prosukomai, screams relationship. It screams us working, God allowing us to work with him, but us inviting God to be involved in this stuff. And that gives us, I think, a critically important understanding of the very nature of prayer. Any questions about that? I'm not recommending that all of you go out and, you know, start and learn Koine Greek, biblical Greek, and, you know, only read from the Allen, you know, Greek New Testament or anything like that. But there are times that being able to do some research like this, at least having access to the tools, this is an example where it really does give you an understanding of what's the meaning behind the words. Because our language doesn't always do a good job, English doesn't always do a good job of directly translating those words. Marvin?
Well, as we said, to many of us, God is our little genie that we bring our request to.
Right.
And ultimately, we are his servants. And we should be praying, "Lead me today to do your will, and help me to serve you. Show me the way to go, show me what to do." And that's getting ourselves aligned with him rather than trying to get him aligned with what we want.
Right. Exactly right. I mean, you all have heard John F. Kennedy in his inaugural address when he said, "Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country." Many, many times I've thought about that and said, you know, if Christians just got it in terms of saying, "Ask not what God can do for you, ask what you can do for God." That should be a more common aspect of our prayer, which is exactly what you're saying. And yet we don't think that way. We think prayer is trying to encourage, bribe, manipulate, arm twist God into doing the stuff that we want, even petty stuff that we want. But God, please give me that new car. I've already got three, but I really want that one. Really? That's not a prayer. Patting somebody on the back. Okay? So any other questions about prayer?
About one, a habit, put your hands together. The hands.
Well, was it in this class that I did the thing where it's from the Peanuts cartoon, and Linus says, I just discovered an important theological point. If you pray with your hands this way, you get what you ask for, but if you pray with your hands upside down, you get the opposite of what you ask for. No, there's nothing about that. I mean, this was always considered an attitude of reverence, is all it is. Just like kneeling is an attitude of reverence. It doesn't mean it's required. You can be reverent standing upright with your hands down to your sides. But a lot of those things simply were aspects of reverence that were sought. Okay? It's also true it gives you something to do with your hands. I say that because, like when I offer communion, when I do the Works of Institution for Communion, I'm standing up there in front of everybody. What do I do with my hands? This is the most natural thing for me to do with them. And I'm sure people think I'm trying to look holy. But in fact, that looks better than this. Okay. And so, you know, there's just some very practical things. It doesn't, theologically, spiritually, I don't think it means anything. It does make a difference if you have an attitude in your heart where you are trying to be, present before God in a meaningful way. Okay? Here first and then Seth. Yes?
There's the lifting up of hands. If you're, and sometimes in my private prayer, I would lift up my hands. It just seemed like the most natural thing in the world to do. And another is to be prostrate.
Yeah,
prostrate. Prostrate.
Lay down. You can't be prostrate, but that's okay.
Head on the floor.
It's true.
There's something about that of surrender. Yep. That I am surrendering myself in the position of the body, like kneeling. When it's done with the heart, you really there's just a closer, intimate relationship with the Lord.
That is true, and I'm glad you said that because I want to clarify something I just said. There's no requirement about this. You're not being more pious when you do that. But it is also true that what we do with our bodies affects what happens in us spiritually. I mean, we know for a fact that the link between the mind and the body, the idea of psychosomatic kinds of things, the relationship between the mind and the body is an absolute truth. Well, the same thing is true between the body and the spirit. There are, you know, if I'm coming before the Lord to pray and I slouch down on my chair and put one leg over the arm and I'm just like, well, God, you know, I am not going to have the same attitude of recognition of God's presence as if I'm kneeling or I'm sitting, you know, with my hands folded or whatever it is. What we do with our bodies frequently will make a difference in how we are affected spiritually. Kneeling has an impact. I agree, there are times when lifting your hands, which is a symbol of openness and of receptivity, you know, you are open to receiving the things of God, it does make a difference in how you feel, how you interact spiritually. The idea of being prostrate on your face is the ultimate humbling position. And so when you're coming before the Lord beseeching Him or in confession for your sin, for instance, then there perhaps is no more effective way and nothing that will cause you to feel more both the confession and also the openness to God, you know, in a humble way than to be on your face.
Didn't there be a lot of Old Testament people that went down on their face before the Lord?
Well, absolutely, and New Testament people as well. But it's always been considered, and not just in Christianity. I mean, the same thing is true. You've seen Muslims in prayer, okay? There's a reason why, in fact, I don't know if you ever noticed this, but in the ancient Near East, the Middle East, the kinds of hats they wear, turbans, kafiyas, fez, you know why those are all common in the Middle East? They don't have brims. So there, you can put your forehead on the ground. Can't do that with a baseball cap or a sun hat or anything like that. That's the reason those hats are common, is because part of the ritual of prayer in the Islamic faith is you kneel There are several places you put your forehead on the ground. All of these are aspects of humbling yourself, of recognizing the greatness of God and of your insignificance in the face of Him. And then you look to your left and you look to your right because you're recognizing that you are part of the body of believers who are worshiping God. And there's all sorts of things. I'm not recommending that you do, you know, prayer five times a day in the Islamic form. But there's something about them that they've got part of that right, and we don't. Okay? And some of it is that they recognize that what they do with their bodies makes a difference in what's happening with them spiritually. Right? But you didn't know that about the hats, did you?
No.
Okay.
I might have like that.
Exactly. All right. I've got about 3 minutes till 2. Let's take a break until 5 after. Let's talk about angels. First, let me start by saying that if there is, I think it's on. I don't think it was ever turned off. I hope not. Yeah, check it, make sure it says record. There are a lot of people who would insist that they're Christians, they believe in God, they believe in Jesus, etc., etc. But when you start talking about angels and demons, they go, nah, not so much. Well, let me tell you, folks, if you do not believe in angels and demons, there's only one reason why that could be, and that's because you have problems believing in the supernatural. If you have problems believing in the supernatural, including angels and demons, then that means you don't believe the Bible, because the New Testament is full of angels and demons. If you took every circumstance where Jesus cast out a demon and removed it, you'd have Swiss cheese at best. The Bible. You cannot remove that. You can't remove the references to angels and demons, especially demons. You can't remove the supernatural without completely destroying all of our beliefs. And so let's talk about angels and demons and why that's important. First, what is an angel? My definition are, don't laugh, I have a right to have a definition, it's my class. My definition are angels are immortal spiritual beings without material bodies, with personal intellect, emotions, and will, created by God to serve Him. Now, do we have any Lutherans in our group? Any Lutheritarians, as we call them in our church? Okay, Al. Luther. Luther's definition is very close to mine, so he's right. An angel is a spiritual creature created by God without a body for the service of Christendom and the church. We don't use the term Christendom much anymore because there really isn't one. Christendom was the ancient sort of geopolitical part of the world that was Christian, and it's broken up so much now. But the idea that angels are, they are immortal, but not eternal like God. The difference is, angels were created at a certain point. They do not die. They will live forever once they are created, but they are not divine. They were part of the created order that God ordained. Okay? So, let's go through what I call an angelic summary here of facts. And I've got scripture verses here. I'm not going to spend time on all the scriptures, but you can look them up because all this stuff is online. First, angels really do exist. You deny the existence of angels. You deny the existence of the supernatural. You do not have a biblical faith. There's no other way to look at it than that. We can't deny the existence of angels and demons without the consequences being that our faith no longer holds together. If you have a problem with that, go back and read all these verses and see what Scripture says about these things. So they do really exist. Angels are here, now, present with us. They are spiritual, and in most instances, we cannot see them, although the Bible is full of occurrences where angels made themselves visible to Abram, to Sarai, to Jacob, to Joseph, and Mary, etc., etc., etc. They can make themselves visible to the shepherds in the fields, abiding in the fields with their flocks by night. But for the most part, they're not visible. Okay, we'll get to some other details later. Angels also are not people's pets. They're not cute. They're not cuddly. They're not these little cherubs with their little bows, you know, that you send at Valentine's. Angels are formidable beings. We know that because the first impression they almost always give to people is that the people are terrified. Why do you think the angels that appear to the shepherds say, "Fear not"? Okay, don't be afraid. Because the way in which the angels usually appear, just inherent in their power, when they do have a manifestation of themselves in some visible form, it's usually awesome in the sense of, you know, terrifying awesome. They are not these little pets. And again, I could give you, well, I can tell you, these are actually the names of some books that I used to own when I taught a class on the truth about angels and demons, and I had to end up burning them before we left Seattle because I wasn't going to give these to anybody. Gary Quinn wrote a book called May the Angels Be With You. It was about how you can communicate with angels. Elizabeth Clare Prophet wrote How to Work with Angels. Vanessa Lambert wrote a book of angel messages. Robert Graham, not related to Billy, wrote an article called Angel Talk. Are you listening? You know, communicating with angels. 5 Hot Tips for Tuning into Angels. There's an article written by somebody named Lassos. Okay? And on and on. All of those sort of imply that angels are there to be our pets, that we can control them, that they'll do our bidding. They're not there to do our bidding. They are there to help us, but only because they're doing God's bidding. There's a difference. Barbara.
I just wanted you to share several of the 5 hot tips.
Oh, well, I got rid of that book and somehow I don't remember them. Again, I was giving books away to churches. I was giving books away to Goodwill. Carolyn and I were. And I thought, I'm not giving this to a church. I'm not giving it to Goodwill. I'm not going to have somebody else misled this. So I had to have a bonfire and get rid of some of it. I also had books on Satanism and all kinds of stuff that I had for the sake of understanding this, you know, but I wasn't going to give them to somebody else because I felt confident that I could read these things in order to understand what the enemy was saying and doing, but I wasn't going to make it available to somebody else who might not have enough experience or maturity to be able to make discrete judgments about that, okay? Next point, angels are spirits. They do not inherently have a physical form, though they can sometimes appear in physical form as God desires it. Angels sometimes appear in disguise. Hebrews 1:7 says that some people have entertained angels unawares, meaning you stop and pick up a hitchhiker. I'm not recommending you pick up hitchhikers, but or you care for somebody that you meet on the street. You show compassion to somebody who seems to be in need. Scripture says you may actually have been caring for an angel. It may be that angel was there in order to give you an opportunity to show compassion, because that in itself is honoring to God. So they may appear disguised sometimes. Next, angels are aware of you, even if you're not aware of them. One of the things that we find in Scripture is that, we'll talk about demons in a minute, but it's especially true, the angels seem to know what's happening, right? Now, angels cannot read minds. Demons cannot read minds. But they can, they are around all the time, and they see things that happen. When a demon shows up and says, well, I can prove you have power, I know what you had for breakfast this morning. Well, maybe he knows because he was there and saw what you had for breakfast this morning. You just weren't aware of his presence. You see my point? While they are powerful, they are not God. There is a limit on their power. They don't read minds or whatever, but they are here. There is a spiritual realm all around us that we are not naturally aware of. Now, somebody is going to mention the Frank Peretti books, This Present Darkness, etc. Now, I really appreciate the fact that Peretti is the first writer I'm aware of, in terms of a fictional writing, that tried to take seriously the fact that there is a spiritual realm around us, that there are angels and there are demons, and we happen to be living in the battleground between those two. And I appreciate that. I don't think his books are particularly well written. So, but he's trying. You know, he's trying to make us aware. You know Frank Peretti? Okay, yes. His Present Darkness was the first one he wrote. And he writes about people's experience, and in fact, people are doing things they're not aware of, all the spiritual things are happening around them with angels and demons, and that's accurate biblically. All right, so they're aware of us even if we're not aware of them. And do spend some time, if you're interested, and read these various passages, because I don't have time to go through them all. Angels really do watch over and protect people. The idea of a guardian angel, you can defend that from Scripture, because there are places where it says that God has his angels watching over you, where it says that the angels of the little ones, when they are oppressed, that the angels are speaking to God about that. Now, you don't have to interpret that as though I have an angel and you have an angel and you have an angel. It may be that various angels are assigned to care for our needs at various times. But it's clear in Scripture that that's part of what angels are responsible to do, is to look out for God's children. There have been different doctrines with regard to guardian angels over the years. Thomas Aquinas insisted that everyone is assigned an angel at birth, whether they're going to come to belief or not. Basil and others of the early church fathers argued that only Christians were assigned guardian angels. The Protestant churches have never had a doctrine related to guardian angels. It doesn't show up anywhere in our creeds or anything else, but the Catholic Church does. Officially, the Catholic Church recognizes guardian angels as being assigned to individuals, Catholics, by God to look out for them. All right, but whether we have a guardian angel or not, see, the problem with that is that you then get people saying how to email your guardian angel, you know, how to find out your guardian angel's name or email address or whatever it is. And so there's a danger there, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But they do watch over us. That is clear in Scripture. It's also true that there are evil fallen angels, which we call demons or devils. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in a minute when I talk about the fourth part of today's class, which is demons. And a great war is ongoing between angels and demons, and we are living on part of that battlefield. And we experience some of the fallout from that battle. Barbara.
What's the difference between demons and devils?
They're the same thing.
Only one devil.
Well, devil with a capital D,
yes.
Is Satan,
yes.
Or Lucifer. I'll mention him in a minute. But devils with a small d and plural, is just another way of saying demons. Devil with a capital D means he's number one. Okay. He's the top of the order of devils or demons. But devil or demon are interchangeable. Okay. Other questions about this angelic review? Okay. Let me say that angels serve four primary roles, according to Scripture. The first one is that they are God's attendants, His servants, and His ministers. Not minsters. Minsters is a big church. Ministers. I've got to prove this stuff. Psalm 104:4 says that they are, you know, the creatures of light who are ministers of God, meaning they're the ones that God sends out on errands of various kinds, and that some of them are present before Him to praise Him. That is their chief role. The seraphim is an order of angels whose entire responsibility, apparently, are to provide praise to God. And it's not because God is, you know, is needy or is greedy or selfish. It's because He alone is truly deserving of praise. You know, of all the universe, only God truly deserves to have people have His creatures praising Him at all times. And the seraphim are one category of angels. Actually, there is a historic hierarchy of angels, of which there are 9 levels. Each of those 9 levels are mentioned in Scripture at various times. And they include some you've heard of, like seraphim and cherubim, archangels, and just angels. But there's also some which are called dominions and triumphs and others. And so the traditional understanding is that there are 9 different levels or in the hierarchy of angels, and each of them has a different set of responsibilities. Right? Now, I should say that angel literally means, angelos, the word it comes from, literally means messenger. And so the primary job that the angels have is to be God's messengers. And we see that throughout Scripture. To Abram and Sarai, Jacob, Joseph and Mary, the shepherds, etc. I mentioned those before. Over and over again, when God wants to communicate a message, He frequently does it by sending one of His messengers, or angels. Now, there are only 2 angels named in Scripture. That is the archangel Michael, who is the lieutenant of God's armies, because the third role for angels is as God's warriors. Michael is identified as the chief lieutenant, or the commander-in-chief of the armies of God. And in Revelation, when the time comes where God says enough, a lot of people have this, without realizing it, they have this dualistic idea that God and the devil are equal powers of good and evil, and that someday God will defeat the devil. No, the devil is a created being. I'm getting ahead of myself here. And it is the archangel Michael who is sent to defeat Lucifer or Satan, the devil, at the end of time. Not God the Father, not Jesus. The archangel Michael defeats Satan and throws him into the pit. Okay. And the fourth reason for the angel's existence is as God's assistance in protecting and caring for human needs. Some of those passages I just mentioned which are interpreted as indicating that there are perhaps guardian angels. Now, as I said, people have trouble believing in angels. There really are three different sets of beliefs that people may have about angels. First, people don't believe in them at all. They think it's just mythology or superstition or whatever else. Secondly, they believe in them, but exactly what they believe varies, and it can get very strange, like how to email your guardian angel and all that stuff. Or third, they believe in angels and demons as presented in Scripture and as understood by the first Jews and then Christians down through history. All three of the monotheistic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, in their historical order, all three have basically the same beliefs about angels. And much of it's based upon the Judaic understanding of what angels are. There's actually more talk about angels and demons in the New Testament than in the Old Testament, but still it's clearly evident in the Old Testament that angels are sent by God to do his bidding of various kinds. In fact, throughout Scripture, there are 273 different references to angelic beings in 34 different books in the Bible. There's a little more in the New Testament than the Old Testament. There's 165 references in the New Testament, 108 in the Old Testament. But clearly, there is a predominance of evidence in Scripture about the existence of angels and demons. And in Judaism, they have a fascinating system of traditional beliefs, not biblical beliefs, but traditional beliefs about angels. The angel of the Lord is a term that's used in the Old Testament. Well, the Jewish tradition has named him. His name is Akhtariel. The angel Uriel, you may have heard of, or fire of God, is one of the cherubim who was sent to guard Eden and then warned Noah of the flood, wrestled with Jacob, and on. They've got names for all these different angels. Some of those things have leaked over into Christian beliefs, and if you ask people, you know, what are the names of the four archangels, they might be able to tell you, well, there's only two of them mentioned. Michael and Gabriel are the only ones we have names for. Uriel and Ariel and some of the others are traditional names from Judaism. They're not really part of Scripture. It's also true that some ancient religions were known to worship angels as gods. In fact, there are some specific references in the Old Testament to angelic beings trying, when they fell as demons, trying to be worshipped. There's a strong idea that the demonic powers got themselves identified as gods in the Old Testament pagan world. And when they were worshipping Chemosh and Molech and some of the others, these were actually demons who had convinced various ancient peoples that they were deities and had convinced them to worship them. And that's why most of the worship of those ancient pagan deities involved some sort of destruction, either the sacrifice of children or of self-mutilation. You remember when Elijah is having the contest with the prophets of Baal, and the prophets of Baal go first, and they're yelling and screaming and banging drums and cutting themselves to try to get Baal's attention, and the whole time that they're doing that, Elijah's standing up on the side trash-talking them. You know, what's wrong? Is your God asleep? Is he in the toilet? Is he going on vacation? Do you need to wake him up? Maybe scream louder. He's doing this the whole time, for hours. But self-mutilation was one of the things they would do as part of their worship. And so always, when you look at the pagan gods and how part of their worship involved destruction, either damage to yourself or damage to the created order in some way, the death of children and sacrifice, is an example of the fact that the demonic powers were looking to try to harm the good that is in God's creation. Okay? Let's talk about demons a little bit, since I'm getting into that. So what is a demon? Demons are fallen angels who, out of pride, and under the leadership of Satan, rebelled against God, were cast out of heaven, and now work against God until the final consummation. I've done my Billy Graham imitation for you, haven't I? You heard that?
You can do it again.
It wasn't Billy Graham I heard say this, but I heard a comedian say, you know, like a brother Billy Graham says, when Satan fell, he took one third of the angels with him. You know what that means? We got it outnumbered, 2-1. There are not a lot of specific references in the Bible to either angelic or demonic origins. The indication is that the angelic beings were created probably on the first day of creation, because it says that the hosts of heaven sang in praise and celebration at the rest of God's creation. So the indication is probably on the first day of creation is when they came along. Certainly they are created beings, created very early in the process, and at some point, very early on, somewhere between that first day of creation and Adam and Eve in the garden, the angels fell. Again, not a lot of details. It does say that one third of the, you know, the star fell from heaven, and one third of the angel of the stars fell with him, or were swept from the sky, it actually says, with him. The clear indication from some of that metaphorical language is that when Satan fell, he took one third of the angels with him. One third of the stars were swept from the sky by the tail of the dragon kind of thing. We don't have a lot more detail. And the point that we always have to remember is, if God wanted us to know much more about this, he would have told us. The fact that there's not a lot more detail, I believe, is an indication of the fact that we are so, as human beings, so oriented to dealing, trying to make a major issue out of minor stuff, that God didn't give us a lot of detail, and so we end up making it up anyway. We are not supposed to be focusing that much on angels and demons, or he would have told us more about them. Right? It's pretty simple. The demons represented themselves as gods in ancient times, which is why, as I said, the worship of false god has often been so destructive. These two passages from Deuteronomy and Psalm talk about the fact that when they were sacrificing their children, they were doing so to demons. And when they were offering up praise to these gods, it was in fact demonic powers that they were worshiping. So there's scriptural support for my statement about that. And as I said before, this is not dualism. Satan, who is linked to the angel Lucifer. The angel Lucifer was the angel of light. And so the clear understanding is, and traditionally the most beautiful of all the angels, it has been astrologically linked to Venus, which is the, you know, the morning star. The planet Venus, Lucifer, the angel of light, and Satan have always been linked with each other. And Satan, the very word Shatan, means adversary, the opponent, which is actually the same meaning as Diabolos, which where we get devil or diabolical. That too means adversary. They are the enemies, the opponents of humanity, and seek to do them ill. But it is not dualism. As I said, in the end, it is the Archangel Michael who will be sent to deal with Satan, who will chain him and cast him into the lake of fire prepared for the devil and his demons, as Jesus said. It is not that God has got to struggle with this. It would not be a monotheistic religion if God and the devil were equal. The devil is a created being and is not the equal to God. In fact, I think I've said before, I mentioned three monotheistic religions, the three great historic monotheistic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Some people identify Zoroastrianism, the ancient Persian religion, as being monotheistic because they identify one supreme deity, Ahura Mazda. But then part of their belief is that throughout the whole history of the universe, there has been a fight, a competition, evenly fought between Ahura Mazda and Agrion, which is the evil deity. And it can't really be a monotheistic religion if their whole concept of how things have happened in the history of the universe is that there are these two powers that are equal and are constantly fighting each other. So I think Zoroastrianism is a dualistic religion. Ours is not a dualistic religion. There is only one uncreated being, God. Every other creature was made by God. First, the angels. The angels were made with personal intellect and will and the ability to make a decision. They do not have physical bodies. They don't have physical wings either. The whole idea of wings is just, it's an ancient traditional way of trying to say they can get from point A to point B really fast. The fastest way anybody ever knew to do that is if you could fly. So they traditionally gave angels wings. They also gave them halos. Halo was just a traditional way of identifying something as being holy, good, wise, pious. The part about getting from one place to another, interesting. Mortimer Adler was a great writer. If you ever have a chance to read any of Adler's stuff, he was a sort of a religious philosopher, sociologist. Mortimer Adler was once describing to Niels Bohr. Niels Bohr was one of the early nuclear scientists. You know, he's responsible for a lot of the understanding of what led to the atomic bomb, but also after that to much of what we understand as quantum mechanics. You mentioned string theory, that came a little bit later, but it was based on that. Well, Niels Bohr, this great nuclear physicist, Mortimer Adler once described to Niels Bohr that Thomas Aquinas had said that angels were capable of passing instantaneously from one place to another without having to pass through the distance in between. And Niels Bohr was just astonished, and he said that's the basic principle behind quantum mechanics. The idea that particles can disappear and reappear in various places without having to connect between the two. And Bohr was really astonished that a 13th century theologian had discovered one of the basic principles of modern nuclear physics in his concept of how angels move from place to place. And you get into the Heisenberg uncertainty principle and the appearance and disappearance of particles and all that kind of stuff. Next week we'll talk about quantum mechanics. Because we can go anywhere and do anything we want. Any questions about that? There's some other stuff I can get into here, and I'm wondering how deep I want to go into this. Yes?
Well, sorry to keep...
No.
Antichrist, it's not really demons or angelic, but definitely of Satan. Can you talk about that? Or
well, we'll get into the doctrine of eschatology. We actually dealt with that a little bit in our theology of New Testament and Old Testament. But the Antichrist is perceived as being a person. A person who is given over to, who is given himself or herself, it should be probably himself, because only men would do this kind of stuff, to the power of Satan, as represented by the great dragon, and you know there is a priest that represents, but the idea is that while they are demonically driven and possessed, if you want to say that, although I agree with Gruden that demon possessed is not a useful term, that it is a human that is doing the work of Satan and his goals. We'll talk about that more when we get to systematic theology too, when we get to eschatology, the church and the future kind of stuff. But it is worth identifying the fact that demons, as spiritual beings, do desire to harm us, even more so if we are on the side of God. I'll get you into second set. Someone had said one time that, you know, the devil doesn't want to bother the people who are on his team. If somebody's having a problem, it's probably because the devil's not happy with them. The people that he likes, that are doing his work for him, he pretty much is going to leave them alone. But the idea is that the demons are actively trying to affect us, hurt us, damage our witness, all sorts of things. Now the question comes up, and Gruden deals with this, of demon possession. That's not a useful term. I've been asking classes before, can Christians be demon possessed? There are very few instances in Scripture where we have an example of real possession, where a person is so thoroughly taken over by demonic presence that they no longer have control of themselves. The demoniac in the Gennesaret tale that Jesus frees from the demon and then he's found sitting talking to Jesus in his right mind and all of that. It's one of the few examples we have where an entire person was taken over. In most cases, it's that a demon is causing harm, is affecting a person, throwing the boy into the fire or water, that sort of thing. Christians can experience that kind of harm because we are not completely free from demonic oppression. Now, the extent to which we are committed to Christ, that we allow the Holy Spirit to be indwelling us, the extent to which we've become more holy, more Christ-like, we are less likely to have those influences against us. But even those who have professed faith in Christ but do not have a strong faith, are not secure in His Word, because it says that, you know, being in the Word of God and having the Word of God in us is one of the protections against demonic influence. And so that's a critical part of it. There's a direct correlation, in other words, between the level of maturity of a Christian and the likelihood that they may in some way be affected by demonic influence. Seth?
Yeah, this is kind of back to the angels, but it makes reference to the angel of the Lord in the scripture. I think Moses when he was gonna, when they were in the desert maybe.
Right.
God said, you know, the angel of the Lord will be with me. He said, no, I don't want to go unless I have your presence. What is the angel of the Lord?
Some people believe that's a reference to God himself, that it is a present, that God has made himself manifest directly. The Jewish tradition is that's one of the ones they have a name for. It's Astariel, I think, which means he was seen as one of the senior angels who could actually speak for the Lord as though he were the Lord himself. So there's two different ways of viewing that maybe it was actually God was making his own presence manifest in some way, wrestling with Jacob, etc. Or it may have been that this was one of the senior orders of angel that is not named, even though the Jews have traditionally given it a name. So beyond that, we don't know. As I say, there's a whole lot about angels and demons. We don't know. What we do know, we can study and we can understand, but we can't presume to try to construct, you know, fill in the gaps and the holes, because that's what gets people in trouble. It has, Scripture is very clear in saying that you are not to worship angels. In fact, the book of Colossians, Paul tells the church in Colossae that somebody apparently had come along and suggested to them that they should worship angels. And he said, absolutely not. We have in the book of Revelation, John, when he's having this vision, an angel is showing him around, you know, the heaven, and John is so impressed, he falls down to worship this angelic being, and the being said, get up! What are you doing? You don't worship me, you worship him! Okay, referring to God. And so there's very clear indication that while people have often been tempted toward worshiping of angels or of demons, neither one is appropriate. Not even the highest order of angels are to be worshipped. But rather, we worship the God who is responsible for them as well as everything else. Okay? Other questions? You just rubbing your neck back there, Barbara? Or
yep.
Is there something? Okay.
Yep.
Yes?
One of the things you point out on that is not to worship any angels, and is that Jesus definitely separated himself from the angels in that he received worship. And
correct.
Shows it. And, because there are a lot of people that just want to say, oh, he was a good man,
a good being.
And that was one of the ways that he clearly showed that he was divine.
Yeah, he did receive worship. And in fact, people who say, oh, Jesus never claimed to be God. Well, he never corrected anybody who called him God. He never stopped anybody who offered him worship. It was very clear that Jesus accepted that role, perceived himself that way, in a way that the angels were not. Let me give you a couple of the verses that refer to the, particularly in Isaiah, refer to Lucifer, etc. Isaiah 14, 12, 15 says, this is the King James I'm reading from. Actually, let me read you the NIV version. How you have fallen from heaven, O morning star. Now the original King James says, O Lucifer. That's where we get that name. Lucifer is the morning star, the bright and morning star, it's sometimes called, which is what they call Venus. That's why that link is there. Because it's the morning star because Venus comes up before the sun does. So that you have, you know, as the moon is waning, the Venus will arise, and that's the morning star. How you have fallen from heaven, O morning star, son of the dawn. You have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven, I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the mount of the assembly, on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. But you are brought down to the grave, to the depths of the pit. As I say elsewhere, it says that the tail of the dragon swept one-third of the skies one-third of the stars from the sky. So you'll notice that statement in Isaiah about what Lucifer was claiming, that I will make myself like the Most High, what was the temptation that the devil, now it calls him the Satan, that old corrupter, but there's always been a clear understanding that the image of the serpent in the garden is the devil, is Satan. What was it that he tempted Eve with?
To be like God.
You won't be like God, being able to tell good from evil. So the same thing that tempted Satan to make himself like the Most High is exactly what he then tempted humanity with. You will be made like God, able to perceive the difference, able to perceive both good and evil. He is, you know, the devil is the prince of this world, we're told. He's the god of this age, both in John 12 and 2 Corinthians 4. And he, by God's will, for now, has control of things. again, Martin Luther for the Lutherans, and how firm a foundation, you know. He talks about our enemy on this earth. On earth is not his equal. The devil is powerful. He is not as powerful as God or even of the other angels, but he is powerful. He is beyond us. And he does rule the fallen earth for now, only as far as God lets him. But he is running rampant, wandering to and fro across the earth, seeking whom he may devour. And we have to recognize that. And so there is a battle going on. Sometimes we're caught in the middle, sometimes we're actually called into the battle. And Scripture gives us indication of what to do about that. Any other questions or comments about that? Miracles, prayers, angels, demons. Yes?
Okay, demons were created, they were, and they fell. And we know that they had to be fallen before Adam and Eve because... Mm-hmm. Okay, do you have any idea, like, that people who believe in creation in seven 24-hour days, how they deal with it?
Satan had to hurry. The idea that if Satan was created on the first day of creation, then humanity, Adam, was made on the sixth day of creation, and then God rested. At some point, right after that, Eve was made. Well, you know, let us make man and woman, we created them. And then they had some time of fellowship in there in the garden, and then the serpent showed up. So somewhere in that period of time, the devil and his demons had to have rebelled against God and fallen from grace, and the devil had enough time to recover his senses to get back down there and try to tempt Adam and Eve. It's a rush. Okay? I'm not an advocate for seven literal days of creation. Yes?
Did these angels mate with women?
No. The idea of the Nephilim having been angels that intermarried with the sons of God, that intermarried with the children of men, the idea that maybe they were angels that bred with people. No, that's really stretching it. There's no real justification for that, especially because, one, angels don't have physical bodies. They sometimes can have the appearance of physical bodies when people need to see them, but they don't have physical bodies. So procreation would be hard. Secondly, angels are a completely different species than us. It's not that angels are just a more advanced humanity so that they can come down and breed with people. That doesn't work. Animals don't cross, beings don't cross pollinate in that way. And so the best interpretation of the Nephilim, I told Ken at the break, I think it was Ken, that I don't even get into that whole Nephilim argument because people have such wild, wild ideas about it. The most likely is that the line that God had blessed through, from the very earliest, from the family of Adam and Eve, there was a line that was God, that blessed people of God, through whom we have the descent to Abraham and then on down all the way to Jesus. And there were those who were the children of Cain, after Cain killed Abel, that were not following God. They were not the people of God. When it says the sons of God intermarried with the daughters of men, the best interpretation of that, which is not ironclad, is that it means the line that was of Seth, the line that was blessed by God, intermarried with the children, the descendants of Cain. So the children of God, the children of men, the blessed lineage that God ordained and those that were not. That's the best interpretation. Beyond that, we don't really know what it means. But it does not, and you hear people say that, angels intermarried with people, with women, different species, they don't have bodies. Doesn't work that way, okay? Oh, he can't talk, so Rich, hand me his note. Now we're passing notes. Okay. If angels are protecting us against evil, why are demons winning, as exemplified by immorality, abortion, porn, murder, etc., more now than ever before, in my opinion? Well, angels are protecting us, but not from everything. We still have free will. It's not like God sends the angels in order to enforce on us what's in our best interest. God still gives us the opportunity to select evil. The demons don't have any power to force us to do evil. They'll tempt us to evil. The devil in the garden, as the serpent, didn't force Eve to follow along what he wanted. He tempted her to do it. So the reason that evil still exists until that day, the final consummation, is because we make those choices. I mean, the things you mentioned here, immorality, we choose to be immoral. Abortion, we choose to have abortion. Pornography, murder, etc., those are human choices. The angels will protect those who are seeking after God, who desire His protection, who ask for His protection. That doesn't mean that the angels are going to force us to always make the right choices. We still have freedom. God does not take that away from us. Does that help? Okay? Yes, Ken.
One comment on that is, which is easier to eat, a salad or a piece of chocolate cake?
Which is easier to eat, a salad or a piece of chocolate cake? You know, there are choices, yeah.
Yeah, and it's much easier to choose wrong.
You're assuming that a salad is evil, right?
That's right.
Okay. Two verses too, and I mentioned this, Deuteronomy and Psalm. Let me actually read those to you. Psalm 106 at least. Speaking of people in ancient times, they worshipped their idols who became a snare to them. They sacrificed their sons and their daughters to demons. So the ancient gods, they called for child sacrifice, were not deities. They were demons that had pretended to be demons. And there's also a passage I don't have up here, 1 Corinthians 10, 19-22. Do I mean, Paul writes, then that a sacrifice offered to an idol is anything, or that an idol is anything? No, but the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons, not to God. And I do not want you to be participants with demons. So there is scriptural support for the idea that the pagan gods that were worshipped were demonic powers who wanted to be worshipped and therefore convinced people that they actually were gods, when in fact they're not. They're created beings, fallen angels. Any other questions?
There's a movie on tonight, The Son of God.
I think it just excerpts.
Oh.
Okay, well, yeah, The Son of God is the new movie by Mark, what's his name, in
husband?
The people who did the Bible?
Oh, yeah.
They have a new movie called The Son of God.
Oh.
I had an email from Rick Warren asking me to come to church for a showing of that. Of course, I'm down here. Like he sent it to 20,000 people. But
you were number one.
Exactly. All right, that's it. I don't have anything else to say today. I'm going to give you 12 extra minutes.